Good morning and welcome to you all from ICF Portimao. We wish Andrew Dalton a very happy birthday for the 21st of this month. Please, Andrew, have a lovely day. We will be thinking of you here in the Algarve. I was given this book. It's called Book of Comfortable Words. And this was given to me by Jenny Grainer. It was compiled by her, and I'm sure many of you remember her. This book has got a lot of lovely, lovely bits and pieces in, and a lot of the contributions were by ICF people, but unfortunately they didn't leave their names. So the first one that I'm going to read to you is from an author unknown, but it's contributed by the ICF, and it's called A Useful Vessel. It's not what we keep, but what we share. Not what we have, but what we spare. Not what we clasp, but what we lose. Not what we hide, but what we use. A vessel he will make of you, if small or great, 'twill surely do. Great joy and peace will always fill the one who's yielded to his will. And there's one little one here that I just had a real giggle at, and it's called The Best Prayer. The best prayer I ever heard was, "Dear God, please help me to be the person my dog thinks I am." And this was also a contribution by ICF, but also anonymous. Could you please bow our heads and say the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Stretch from shore to shore, till sun shines and set no more. Blessings about where he reigns, the prisoner leaps to lose his chains.
Remember to finish your breakfast.
Okay, Dad.
Almost time for school. Don't forget your books. Don't forget to wash up. Remember to get ready for bed.
Verse 6 says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." Our loving Heavenly Father, we come to you today with our worship, thanks and praise for all your blessings to us day by day. For temporal and spiritual blessings, thank you for the forgiveness of all our sins and the wonderful hope of eternal life with you. We thank you for family and friends. May we be a great blessing to them each day. We pray for all our government leaders. Give them wisdom as they seek to lead us out of this pandemic time. We are grateful for the vaccines rolling out and the numbers of deaths are falling. Please comfort all who mourn the loss of loved ones to COVID. You are the God of all comfort and grace. Bless your church in Portimao and all over the world, especially the persecuted Church of Jesus in many countries. Bless those who truly suffer for their faith in Jesus and their families. Give them courage to remain firm in faith. Please bless the medical services in Portugal and all other countries represented in our church family. Uphold the doctors and nurses in their work, caring for the dying and very sick patients. Thank you, finally, that you are not in lockdown. We can always call upon you wherever we are. Please bless your word today through joy and the final message of the temptations of the Lord Jesus. We give you thanks for your love, grace and mercy today to each of us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
The joys and for the sorrows, the best and worst of times, for this moment, for tomorrow, for all that lies behind. Fears the crowd around me, for the failure of my plans, for the dreams of all I Jesus, for this I have Jesus, I have Jesus. For the tears that flow in secret in the broken time, for the moments of elation, all the troubled mind, for all the disappointments, all the sting of all regrets, all my prayers and longings that seem unanswered yet. For this I have Jesus. for this I have Jesus. For this I have Jesus. I have Jesus. For this I have Jesus.
Reading is taken from Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you're the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. So if you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "It says, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time.
Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the royal master leads against the foe. Forward into battle, see his banners go. Onward, with the cross of Jesus going on.
Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us again for our worship service. And I'd like to wish all the ladies a very happy Mother's Day. It's Mother's Day in England today. So very happy Mother's Day to all the ladies. And today marks a year since we started doing online services. Who would have thought that a year ago that we'd still be doing these? But you know, it's been a real blessing in many ways. And it's especially a blessing to be able to have fellowship with people who wouldn't ordinarily be in Portimao at this time. So God is good and he works in spite of our difficulties. So thank you. Thank you for being with us, all of you. So let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin our time of study of his word. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for your word, your precious word that you've preserved for us to teach us and instruct us, to warn us, to encourage us. Lord, thank you for your word. And as we open it today, Lord, I just pray that you would speak to us. Show us, Lord, how to apply it to our lives so that we might be faithful servants of you and be able to serve you better. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Now, Jesus' time of intensive testing in the wilderness is intended to show us that he was tempted in every way, just as we are. The expression, all this tempting, found in Luke 4, verse 13, means not only all in the sense of the quantity of temptations, but it's also referring to the variety of temptations. Jesus was familiar with all the struggles that we face. Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin." Notice that temptation itself is not sin. It's only giving into it that is. Martin Luther once said, "You cannot keep birds from flying overhead over your head, but you can keep them from building a nest in your hair." Now, you may have noticed that Matthew and Luke record the temptations in a slightly different order. That in itself is not important. What is significant, though, is that the temptations cover every aspect of life in this world. And in Luke's order, we see a progression from the physical to the mental to the spiritual. Temptation on the physical level was to turn stones into bread to satisfy hunger. Temptation on the mental level was to claim an earthly kingdom to satisfy ambition. Temptation on the spiritual level was for Jesus to make a spectacular display of power fueled by pride that his Father would take care of him. About 30 years after Luke wrote his narrative, John would pen the following words in his first letter, chapter 2, verses 15 to 17. "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, and the boasting of what he has or does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lasts forever." John's text seems to parallel the three temptations as recorded by Luke. The cravings of sinful man remind us of the hunger that Jesus felt. The lust of the eyes reminds us of the attractive kingdom that he was offered. The boasting of what man has or does reminds us of the devil's challenge for Jesus to jump from the pinnacle of the temple to show the world that he was the promised Messiah. Jesus was tempted in all ways, just as we are, yet without sin. We can be sure that his temptation experience in the wilderness was not the only occasion when he was tempted. In fact, Luke 4, verse 13 clearly says that the devil left him until an opportune time. In other words, he would be back. Jesus was probably tempted intermittently throughout his whole life, just as we are. Certainly as he wrestled in the Garden of Gethsemane with the horror of all that going to the cross would involve, the devil must surely have been trying his utmost to keep him from going there to redeem us. But it's the account of the temptations in the wilderness where we see the most complete picture of Jesus being tempted. Not only do we see that he was tempted in every way, on every level, but by his example we also learn how we can resist temptation as he did. Jesus always lived in close fellowship with his Father. He had spent 40 days in prayer and fasting, seeking his Father's face, desiring to know and do his will. He had a thorough knowledge of the scriptures and a deep understanding of what they meant. He had the Holy Spirit to guide him and give him the strength to do his Father's will. All of these blessings and privileges we have too. And because Jesus resisted temptation, we can as well. I remember once driving along one of the many narrow cobbled streets in the old part of Portimao near our soup kitchen. And not only was the road tiny, but there were also extra obstacles to navigate, such as parked cars. At one point, a large van squeezed out in front of me and led the way for me. And I found myself thinking, he's a lot bigger than I am. If he can make it through, I can too. And then I realized, you know, there's a message in that. Jesus is much bigger than we are. He has made it through. And if we follow his example and let him lead the way for us, we can make it through as well. And so now we come to the third temptation. As Jesus contemplated the start of his public ministry, one of the questions that might have been in his mind was how would the people know that he was sent from God? How would they know that he was the Messiah and the one that they should follow? These are innocent questions which in his humanity Jesus may well have been pondering. In this third temptation, Satan tried to cash in on any uncertainty Jesus felt by offering him a very clear and very clever way to show the world that he was the Messiah. He offered him a spectacular feat that would remove all doubt once and for all. The setting for this temptation was the pinnacle of the temple in Jerusalem. This is believed to be the highest part of the royal colonnade gallery built by Herod the Great, and it was located on the southeast corner of the Temple Mount, where from a dizzy height it overlooked the Kidron Valley below. First century historian Josephus wrote these words in his Antiquities about this impressive and lofty structure. He wrote, "This cloister deserves to be mentioned better than any other under the sun, for while the valley was very deep and its bottom could not be seen if you looked from above into its depth, this further vastly high elevation of the cloister stood upon that height, insomuch that if anyone looked down from the top of its battlements or down both these altitudes, he would be giddy, while his sight could not reach to such an immense depth." Some scholars think that the height from the pinnacle of the temple down to the Kidron Valley below was as much as 700 feet. It was from this lofty pinnacle that the priest on duty at the temple would keep watch during the night, awaiting the dawn when he would blow his trumpet to summon the faithful to offer the morning sacrifice. This pinnacle was also the very place that the Messiah was expected to appear to the Jewish people in fulfillment of Malachi 3 verse 1. "See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me, then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. So it was here, on the pinnacle of the temple, that Satan goaded Jesus with the words, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." As we look at this temptation, first of all, let's consider the rationale. As we read this narrative, we quickly realize just how cunning the devil is. 1 Peter 5, verse 8 warns us, "Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings." We know that wild animals catch their prey by sneaking up on them unexpectedly. And the devil was certainly very subtle in his approach in the third temptation. He had already learned from the response to the temptation to turn stones into bread that Jesus was trusting his heavenly Father to take care of him. And so now the devil uses that knowledge to his advantage and goads Jesus to prove it. No one could possibly survive a jump from the pinnacle of the temple unless God intervened in a miraculous way. So the temptation was for Jesus to jump and let the world see the spectacular rescue operation by angels that would certainly follow. This would leave the people in no doubt that Jesus was sent from God. And even better, he would descend from the very place where the Messiah was expected. Those waiting in the temple courts below would know for a certainty that the promised Messiah had come. Satan made it seem like a perfect plan and a brilliant idea. 2 Corinthians 11:14 warns us, though, that Satan masquerades as an angel of light. And he certainly tried his best that day to make his suggestion as attractive and as appealing as he possibly could. He used layer upon layer of his disguise. His temptation was cloaked in apparent holiness. This was Jerusalem, the holy city. This was the temple, the holy place. This was the pinnacle, the holy high point, where the faithful were expecting their Messiah. To top it all, the devil even quoted Scripture, the holy book. He knew that Jesus held Scripture in the highest esteem because he'd used it to rebuff him on two previous occasions already. This was the perfect plan. Surely the son wouldn't suspect any mischief. Surely he had him cornered now. Or he thought so, at least. And if by any chance Jesus jumped and God didn't rescue him, well, he would have wiped out his opponent in one fell swoop before he ever had chance to begin his public ministry. Satan was gloating in what seemed like certain success. So we've seen the rationale. Now let's look at the refusal. Jesus gets right to the point in his unhesitating reply, "Do not put the Lord your God to the test." This is a quotation from Deuteronomy 6:16, where God commanded the Israelites, "Do not test the Lord your God as you did at Massah." Exodus 17 gives us the background to this story. Shortly after God's miraculous deliverance of his people from Egypt, when he parted the Red Sea for them to cross to safety, the children of Israel were wandering in the desert and camped at Rephidim. When they didn't see any water there, they started to grumble and started to doubt God, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" after all that God had done, the people expected him to prove his presence and prove his provision by miraculously providing water. And so Moses named the place Massa, which means testing, and Meribah, which means quarreling. In his mercy, God did instruct Moses to strike the rock at Horeb, and water came gushing out for the people to drink. But their lack of trust greatly displeased the Lord. Jesus would not be tricked into making the same mistake as the children of Israel. He made a deliberate choice to trust his heavenly Father for his future, and he refused to set a test to force his Father's hand and make him do what he wanted. In his own way and his own time, the Father would make it known to everyone that Jesus was the promised Messiah. It might have seemed easier to make a spectacular entrance and win the love and loyalty of the people right away. But that was not the Father's will. That was not the Father's way. If it had been, Jesus would have done it. The devil's quoting, or rather misquoting, Psalm 91 is very interesting. The rabbis believe that the person referred to in this psalm, the one who would receive protection from the Almighty, was none other than the Messiah himself. But it's very significant that the devil omits the line to guard you in all your ways. The words of Psalm 91 were never meant to be a blanket promise to cover all situations. They were never intended to inspire us to put ourselves at unnecessary risk so God the Father could save us. Rather, they were and are a promise of protection for the one walking in God's ways and doing his will. This psalm is a promise for the one acting in faith, not the one acting in folly. And so the critical question that Jesus faced that day on the pinnacle of the temple was to test or to trust. The devil wanted Jesus to test the Father. The Son rejected the challenge and chose to trust him. In all the temptations, the devil tried to cast doubt on the Father's love for his Son. If he really loved him, why would he let him go hungry? If he really loved him, why hadn't he already given him the kingdom? If he really loved him, surely he would send thousands of angels to his rescue now. And so the challenge was for Jesus to jump and find out. But Jesus would not be fooled by such deception. There was no doubt in his mind. He was completely confident in his Father's love for him. He knew that his was a love that would never, ever let him go. And he certainly didn't need to jump off the pinnacle of the temple to prove it. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for the wonderful love that you have for us, a love which will never let us go. But Lord, help us not to be foolish. Help us not to put ourselves at unnecessary risk to test your love and to force your hand to rescue us. Oh Lord, help us to learn from the example of Jesus. Help us, Lord, to be devoted to you. Help us, Lord, to faithfully study the scriptures, to find out what your will for us is, and then by the power of your Holy Spirit, to be faithful in doing what you show us to do. Oh Lord, thank you that you are an example to us. Thank you that you have endured temptations on every level. And because you have made it through, because you have resisted, we can too. And so Lord, give us the strength to follow you. Give us the strength to stand up to the devil when he goads us with subtle temptations to lead us astray from you. May we be strong. May we resist because you have resisted and shown us how. We pray these things in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
go, I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths its flow may richer, fuller be. O light that followest all my way, I yield my flickering torch to thee. My heart restores its borrowed ray, that in thy sunshine's blaze its day may brighter, fairer be. O joy that seekest me through pain, I cannot close my heart to thee. I trace the rainbow through the rain, and feel the promise is not vain, that morn shall tearless be. O cross that liftest up my head, I dare not ask to fly from thee. I lay in dust life's glory dead, and from the ground there blossoms red life that shall endless be, life that shall end.